Oh, I want custom Odin colors.
Yeah, I want everything to be custom colored, but Tychus, man, he's just the boy in blue. He really loves that blue. Maybe he wanted to be like an ocean when he was a kid. You know, like those kids that give that really weird response of like, what do you want to be when you grow up? I want to be the ocean. Anyway, let's take a look at the rest of the picks so far. Sergeant Hammer and Chen coming out here from Tempo Storm. We've seen this before. Chen on this map, so strong.
Yeah, and they round out their composition with Jaina. So their damage potential is very high. The slow provided by Jaina is going to make that longbow raid and the Dragon Laser Drill, which is very likely to be seen, incredibly potent. But the barrel disruption will be... we know Glaurung loves playing Chen on this map, so I'm not at all surprised to see this. How do they finalize their roster? Do they feel they need more of that sustainability?
That's actually a really good point. You know, we didn't see Tyrande last match. Are we not going to see Tyrande again? She's not.
I think it'll be Tassadar.
Yeah, Tassadar I think would work out way better just with a Sergeant Hammer, because Tyrande... getting all of that together to make your Sergeant Hammer that much stronger, especially because there's just no burst out of this entire team. It's not going to really emphasize that Hunter's Mark too strongly.
Yeah. And also, you don't get that synergy with the tank for the Lunar Flare. Also, you kind of get anti-synergy, because if the barrel is just kind of pushing them all over the place and you want to try to throw down a Lunar Flare, good luck. Zeebo.
Ooh.
Damage. Look at the push potential. Triple specialist in terms of damage.
Yeah. Remember when, you know, Blizzard released 3 specialists, but they're actually more assassins than anything else?
The whole categorizing is a bit weird in this game.
It is a bit weird, especially because Sylvanas now coming out. Next week, hypes.
Don't mention
call the specialist. Call the specialist doesn't actually, you know, it's also, they're like, yeah, she's like a specialist assassin. Oh, really, Blizzard? Like every other... assassin or specialist you've released.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, so great team coming out from Tempo. Very unorthodox, but it's Cursed Hollow, and we've seen them rock a composition like this before. Pretty excited to see it, because I just love watching Glaurung barrels.
Glaurung barrels, the damage output, like if you're just sitting there getting pushed around while a Ravenous Spirit is ruining your day, you also have to talk about the capability of setting up big maws and then summoning the Ravenous on top of them with Sergeant Hammer sieged up too and throwing Napalm Strike at you. My goodness, that's terrifying.
Yeah, the Ravenous and Barrel. I'm trying to think of how those two work together.
We'll see.
Ravenous is kind of slow.
Yeah, but... also good to point out that there is Tychus on the enemy team.
Yeah.
Easily throw those grenades to interrupt that Ravidus. You have Jaina for massive damage output, and those Vikings are going to be all over the place. The longboat raid has so much damage potential.
It does, but until that Viking longboat raid, Jake, think about it. Think about the fact that we're going to be seeing a Ravidus go straight on through into a set of Vikings.
Yeah, it's going to hurt.
It's going to hurt a lot, so... the Ravenous is actually, I think, a really good pickup. Not only that, but Sergeant Hammer as well. Dude, they have double imposing presence, if I am correct, on C9 Vortex.
They do.
Yeah, okay.
ETC and...
trying to remember if ETC had it or not, but yeah, he definitely does. And Uther, of course, also has it as well. So that Hammer has got to be scared. Arthlon on Hammer at that.
Yeah,
Wait a minute.
If they both do grab imposing presence, we'll probably see the advanced lava strikes at level 20 instead of Nexus Frenzy. It's still very powerful. Hammer, just the damage output, no matter how you look at it, is very good. It'll just encourage less sieging, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, let's talk about this. This is the third place match. This is match point for that third place as well. So whoever wins here is going to get 350. Whoever wins this series, I should say,
because right.
I'm not going to count Cloud9 out. Whoever wins this series is going to win $350.
The losing
team? Loser, 150.
Yeah,
consolation prize, not terrible.
And they made their way all this way to the losers. They made it to the semifinals, now in the losers finals. They're going to get rewarded no matter what, but still a $200 difference, that's a lot to fight for.
It is. And it's, you know, it's a nice little $40 for each person, so I'd consider it well worth it. We're going to get on into this game very shortly. And right after that, guys, we're setting up already our final, or sorry, well, this game, and then potentially the next game, if Cloud9 Vortex is able to turn this around. And then right after that, guys, we're going to get straight on into Cloud9 Maelstrom versus...
Complexity.
All right, guys, let's get on into this game, into the main screen. Let's take a look at our left-hand side. It is Tempo Storm KO playing Zagara Arthalon on Sergeant Hammer, Dreadnought on Rhaegar. Soldier So1Dir playing the Nazebo Witch Doctor, and Glaurung on the Pandaren Brewmaster Chen.
But on the other side, on the red half of the map, that is Cloud9 Vortex with Bobby Hankill playing as Tychus here in the bottom lane. It's going to be the Lost Vikings played by Fan, Syracuse, Rockin' Jaina, Zix on Uther, and rounding it out. Is that everyone? The Vikings confused me.
Taza on ETC. I don't know why I added a southern accent to that.
Taza
on ETC.
You're so silly, playing your little guitar.
Well, it looks like they're going to set up a nice little bush gank right here, because they have those Vikings in each of the lanes. They have to be a little bit scared, though, because Sergeant Hammer and KO sitting in that top lane.
Yeah, but the Vikings, they're doing this again. They're splitting across the map, allowing Vortex to roam as four. And you consider the damage output between the Jaina and the Tychus player, and KO caught out of position, getting blown up. The Cone of Cold didn't connect, but the Blizzard does, and the knockbacks are there to pick up first blood very early in this game.
Looking pretty good already for Cloud9 Vortex. I mean, they have Fan playing Lost Vikings. Fan's Lost Vikings, I think, so far are my favorite Lost Vikings to watch. He's just in every lane, playing it all the time. It's like he's got three different players playing it for him. It's just amazing to watch him play it. And he plays so passively, too. He knows that he doesn't want to, like, put himself in this position where he's constantly having to micro every single one. He puts one back. So it's just soaking experience, not doing too much in each of the lanes, but enough to get that experience soak, and that's all he needs to allow the rest of his team to have a four-man gank squad running around.
But look at Glaurung. Glaurung is actually sitting here in the bottom lane, just soaking up those tower shots by drinking the brew. This has pretty much depleted almost all the ammunition, and this lane is going to push out so quickly if there's no ammunition available.
That's true. Arthalon did a really nice concussive blast to block out Taza as he was sliding on in there. So that was a really, really quick reaction coming out there from Arthalon, and that's just one of those signs of a really, really strong professional player.
Yeah, alright, well, we do see they're pinging Chen. They realize, look, there's no ammo left. Fan can only soak this so long without losing a lot of structural damage. And we do see Fan also in the top lane. He's just being obnoxious on that Olaf, making sure he soaks as much as possible. But with the threat of both Zagara and Hammer there, he is going to be backing up.
You know what's funny is, as long as the Lost Vikings are in Blizzard Heroes of the Storm, you can start saying, like, Fan, oh yeah, he's their top middle and bottom laner.
And yeah, every lane. It's actually this top lane.
In most other MOBAs, you consider somebody, oh yeah, he's their mid laner, he's pretty good, but, you know, you're saying, like, oh yeah, top, yeah, he's their top player. Or Fan, he's their top player. Oh yeah, he's also their mid player. And their bot lane.
Oh, well, Glaurung does manage to pick that up. Fan tried to swoop in there with Eric to try to pick up that kill. We should see the combo coming out onto this Eric. Nearly gonna pick up the kill, the fire! Yes, does.
Oh, wow.
First kill again, very little experience is given over from those Viking kills, and Dreadnought in that wolf form having to run away from these four players in the middle of Vortex.
Doing a really, really nice job. They have given up that tribute in order to kind of push down this lane as much as possible. They didn't actually take out any turrets just yet either, so it's a little bit scary, and they still have this Sergeant Hammer sitting at the top lane. Top tower is almost completely out of ammo, and actually looks like KO did get picked up.
Yeah, KO did lose his life to this four-man squad. But during all of this, I mean, Glaurung is actually sitting in that bottom fort, taking the shots from the fort itself. He's just showing how little he has to even think about this. Those minions are pushing in, and he's just keeping Fans, Eric, in a pretty defensive posture. Second tribute of the game has spawned in the top part of the map.
Wow, Jake, look at that level 4 talent pickup from Arthalon. Excessive force, doubles the knockback. We've seen it a couple times before. Really enjoy seeing it, though. Normally, we see the basic attack range increase at level 4. But yeah, Seeing that super concussive force, really good disengage for ETC. Against ETC.
Right, and on top of that, I mean, we talked about the power of opposing presence in the late game. So he's already just making those reactionary picks. Like, okay, I'm going to be a little bit more utility than I normally would. Olaf gets picked off in the top, so that's going to force somebody from Vortex to defend here in the top lane. But Taza dashing forward. Arthalon does have that knockback. Look how far Taza ends up going. Arthalon, though, not going to be able to get out of that situation.
Trading kills back and forth. I mean, Tempo Storm, they're only picking up a couple of Lost Vikings. Meanwhile, Cloud9 Vortex has picked up 3 kills.
Yeah, and three Vikings for three kills, definitely favorable for Vortex, but they're forcing these Vikings backs doing their best to mitigate this soak. I mean, look at this bottom fort. Glaurung has been uncontested other than a single Viking, and there's a massive wave of minions that are going to plow through it.
Yeah, they have to send almost their entire army to go deal with this, and it actually looks like the creeps are going to still pick up this fort for free.
Yeah, I mean, Taz is trying to knock them back, but it's not going to be enough. The tower, one, two more shots. Oh, my goodness. Survives with 96 health. Their defense is not completely for nothing.
But that tower, the forts, everything else that Tempest Storm has picked up so far, level 10. They've been losing a lot of lives so far, but they picked up level 10, and they're still at a 2-curse advantage. Oh, my God, the Ravenous coming out here from Soldier. Paired up with the Maw, was able to do so much damage.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it. I mean, we talked about that combo in the draft. It is 2-1 in terms of those tributes. And now, after picking up a big win, killing both Tychus and Uther, they are going to start on their own boss.
And yeah, really, really nice play from Tempo Storm. Losing a lot of players here and there in the beginning stage doesn't mean that's going to be game over for them at all. In fact, they're actually still ahead. That comes down to a point I think we made earlier, is that sure, you can get a ton of kills, but that's not the objective of Heroes of the Storm. It helps, it definitely helps, but if you can still pick up all the other objectives, like merc camps, like forts and everything else, you're going to be sitting in a better spot.
Yeah, and they are sitting in that better spot. Full level lead. Fan needs to be cautious with his Vikings. They all share the same cooldown. We do have the Hydras coming down, providing the addition. Baylog very low. Hydra chasing him. Oh, no, misclick. And yeah, he's going to be all right.
Oh, tries to barrel out of there. Glaurung is going to get taken down. Draken Laser Drill to come and disengage the rest of Tempo Storm so they can easily pick up this Golem for themselves. That is three heroics that have gone down here for Cloud9 Vortex. That is going to allow them to pair up, so they have now two tributes. Each team is up to two tributes, so the next tribute spawn is going to be a pretty massive one. Every team has to make sure that they're going to stay alive for it or potentially get a massive advantage.
Yeah, that's a very good thing to point out. Now, this boss being defended right now by KO, he's doing the best he can on Zagara. Bottom boss did get cleaned up on the back wall of the bottom lane there for Cloud9 Vortex, but right now, I mean, it's so even. The quest of 13 gonna be a big part of this next engagement.
It is a massive quest to go on too. I mean, level 13 is pretty nice for a lot of these different these talents. I'm curious to see what Arthlon's actually gonna be picking up at level 13. Did he pick up the Napalm Strike at level 10, which is just, you know, a very, very standard Sergeant Hammer pick, but we've already seen that level 4 pick is a little bit different. But he's also paired that up with a very standard pick of first aid at level 7, so he's playing a little weird, but not completely different from what we're normally used to for Sergeant Hammer.
Yeah, very, very true. Well, Glau and Dread picking up those giants, and it's just about cleaning up those objectives. That tribute spawn should be around the corner. There it is, the fifth tribute of the game. This will grant a curse to the team that manages to acquire it, and Tempo Storm is already in position.
Level 13 grabbed by both teams. Now we see double sprint, one for Jaina, one for Uther coming out here for Cloud9 Vortex. And we're seeing a little bit of an engagement. Zix, oh my god, Bobby Hankill, you are so far back there. But he's able to get away with it, do so much damage. Glaurung barreling on through, doing so much damage. Throws the barricade out on from Arthalon on the level 13 talent. Very, very nice.
Yeah, this double concussive blast pickup is actually proving to be rather interesting. Now, Fan, Longboat Raid has been used. Divine Storm, Water Elemental, Maw, and Ravenous, the only heroics available, but there is that Ravenous going to town. Maw picks up, so that's going to mitigate a lot of the damage that could have been used right then and there, but Zix will fall either way. Soldier needs to be cautious. He does have Sprint available, if I'm not mistaken, and yes, he will be able to get out of the situation.
At least Glaurung has gone down so far. Olaf has fallen as well. The rest of Fan's Lost Viking so incredibly hurt. Arthlon taking a lot of damage, but he's going to be able to heal throughout it. Dreadnought absolutely on point with all of his heals today. I mean, he's only missed like one Ancestral, if that. He's been doing so well on Rhaegar. Our Dreadnought is just a great, great support.
He really, really is, but that's a curse picked up for Tempo Storm. Now, this is the first curse of the game. They have Chen just respawning, so all five players available on the map, and this is the time to start pushing in. Only the giant camp on the right side of the map is available, and I doubt they'll be able to get there in time, so they just want to put that pressure on the middle lane, top lane already being sieged up by the minions.
And that's going to be probably defended here by fans Olaf. He's going to have to go deal with that. But meanwhile, the rest of Tempo Storm going to be pushing down the middle fork.
Yeah, just getting that damage on. So yes, that will be the first fort of the game and just our second fort of the game. Ancestral being used on Soldier. The barrel putting Tazza into a really peculiar position, and he does end up falling.
And that's going to be a second fort pickup and a third fort at the top lane. The top lane auto-pushing by itself because of the curse mechanic. And Tempo Storm just looking incredibly strong here. They've got a pretty good setup so far, but we've seen teams get this far and still fall. So, I mean, this isn't completely Cloud9 is out of this game just yet. Don't count your chickens before they hatch.
Right, but level 16 has been acquired for Tempo Storm, and this allows them to continue maintaining a relatively aggressive stance. ETC will be up in just a couple seconds, but we're going to see Tempo Storm continue to roam around. They're making their way to the bruisers. Their boss will be up in about 20 seconds, and with this, I mean, Vortex has to know that's what they want to do, and they have to weigh their options. Do we try to take a fight without 16, or do we just allow them to pick up their boss?
Well, it becomes a really interesting situation because if they do allow Tempo Storm to pick up this boss, their boss is up in about the next 46 seconds. Boss for Tempo Storm is up now. If Tempo Storm makes the move, goes, successfully gets the boss, guess what? Sometimes that allows you to get enough map control to immediately go pick up the boss top lane, but seems like it's being lagged out enough that both bosses will be up very shortly.
Yeah, and both teams will have 16, so they have done what they need to do to maintain that that even talent advantage. And with that, we're seeing the numbing blast. This is going to help Jaina really deal with Chen diving on her. Jaina does struggle with those kind of heroes that you just can't shake off, like Illidan and Chen, but that's going to make her life a lot easier.
Wow, let's talk about a really interesting level 16 pickup. Holy shock coming out here from Zix's Uther.
This game is just weird.
I am going to tend to say that that's a misclick.
You know what? There's just a lot of new things evolving in this game, and people are starting to try out new compositions in general. We'll see if that pays off. Imposing presence was the obvious choice for the Uther, right? But since this hammer has opted to go for a very unique build, I mean, barricade, the excessive force, and minefield, maybe he's like, well, I don't need it, and I'm going to go for additional, damage?
Yeah, minefield, that's another really weird pickup as well.
In the current meta, yes, it's very.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a really nice counter to the imposing presence meta. Oh my god, stage dive coming in here. Arthalon trying to hold his concussive force for as long as possible. There is a water elemental popped up in the top lane. Napalm strike going straight down on a bunch of Vikings. Glaurung still hasn't popped out his Chen barrel yet. It is going to be a beautiful maul that's only going to hit one of the Vikings, but it's going to separate it enough so it doesn't get on into the boat. It looks like Uther is going to go down here in the beginning, as well as Jaina. Cloud9 Vortex taking a heavy amount of losses, and that's going to be a free boss here for Tempo Storm.
Yeah, I just have to give a ton of props to, I believe it was Zagara and Rhaegar. They body blocked Uther out away from the Ravenous Spirit. They just protected him from the Divine Storm, and that allowed the Ravenous to do what it does and just ruin lives.
Ruin lives. That is so terrifying to hear. The Ravenous, though, yeah, you're completely right. That Ravenous, it not only does it normally ruin lives, but under Soldier's, lock and key, it's just so incredibly well played every single time. It always expertly placed, and he always does it in such a great position so that he's safe and gets pretty much a pretty maximum effect out of it.
Yeah, well, look at this. The top giants, they're sieging up that wall already. Boss walking down that bottom lane. Already, that bottom tower is going to take a few hits before it falls down. So, yes, they can try to fight Tempo Storm at this boss, but their keep is going to take so much damage if they don't respond to it.
Yeah, Tempo Storm knows. They can just back up and just wait for that boss to start doing something, and there's no decision that's going to win here for Cloud9 Vortex, unless they get a complete Tempo Storm wipe here, and even then, that's going to be a little bit difficult. Soldier does get an Ancestral. It's going to keep him alive for pretty long. The Maw going to give him a little bit more time to stay alive. Chen's barrel going to be able to give him a little bit more space. Fans, oh man, the boat immediately canceled out, but Soldier's going to fall very, very quickly. Meanwhile, the boss bot lane is pushing it down. He's doing so much damage. This does give Cloud9 Vortex the ability to go pick up not only this boss, but also possibly the tribute as well. They will lose that fort, but that's not the end of the game. Or that keep, sorry.
Yeah, it's not the end of the game, but that fight was just
crazy. The synergy between the Maw and the Barrel really shine through. They're even pushing them back off of this boss. And if Tazza does fall, we see Baylog fell in the back line. But Arthlon is getting very low. The aggression coming forward, he needs those heals. Dreadnought has been able to maintain that mana to relative good success. But man, this is just so tense right now. And Vortex is backing off.
Oh my god, Tempo Storm able to take it. Not only that, but the core has taken a whole bunch of damage as well.
Yeah, that boss, I mean, you just can't let them pass like that. There will be a curse going onto the side of Tempo Storm. Fan picking that up for Vortex. So that's three tributes in. But is this a time where they can even capitalize on it fully? They have to defend yet another boss.
A boss going down bot lane, mid lane, or sorry, bot lane is already auto pushing because of the keep getting taken down. And mid lane just got cleaned up immediately by the rest of Tempo Storm. Cloud9 Vortex, though, just gives himself a little bit more time to possibly jump themselves back into this game. They're down a level, but they're not completely out just yet.
Look at this, Glaurung in the front line. He has that clairvoyance for vision. He's gonna start on these giants, likely will be forced off by these Vikings if they make the raid down, but no, it looks like they wanna start pushing in. So they're putting on that aggression, but Glaurung, he doesn't know where they are and he doesn't like it one bit. Not worth the risk of picking up giants and losing your life.
Van pushing down mid lane. Looks like the rest of Cloud9 is just trying to stay together and potentially find wherever the heck Tempo Storm is and possibly making a fight, and if not, possibly just getting a whole bunch of objectives and structures dead. I think this is going to be the best call here.
Yeah, well, the curse is going to be expiring in 10 seconds, though. So effectively, they have gotten zero push out of this curse. Tempo Storm was forced to play defensively. So this, you know, in one sense, they just stopped any potential aggression out of Tempo Storm, which is definitely a win. But they used their three tributes, the only three tributes they've had in this game, to defend, essentially.
Yeah, you're completely right. But it gives them just, you know, that little bit more time. The thing is that little bit more time is going to go to Tempo Storm's level 20. And that's, you know, just another one of those big hurdles that a team has to deal with. Level 16, level 13, they're pretty big, but the level 20, once you start getting Bolts of the Storm, you can start getting heavy engages, heavy disengages, do whatever the heck you want, as long as the other team just isn't able to follow up. Looks like they are making a little bit of an aggression down here to try and ward off Tempo Storm from holding off their bottom fort, but I don't think it's going to be too successful.
Yeah, but guess what? That top lane has giants marching down it. One tower has already been removed. Ammunition about to run out on the other tower. And those giants are going to get a lot of damage done if left uncontested. That's why ETC making his way up. He's got that global presence if needed. So he's going to clean those up nice and quick while the rest of the team just kind of falls back into a defensive posture. They're going to clean up those giants. But Temple Storm need to get aggressive.
They got that level 20 hardened shield coming down here on Chen. Bolt on Zagara. Improved Napalm Strike coming out here from Arthalon.
Oh, the range is so far.
Oh, it's so far.
Yeah, I mean, it's the advanced lava strikes. I mean, we likely wouldn't see the full-on siege style. This has been a very utility-oriented Sergeant Hammer, but now he just becomes so potent in the form of damage. Opposing presence doesn't affect that at all, and Eric ends up getting picked off up here. Fan needs to be careful with those other two Vikings.
He really does. I mean, if he loses these Vikings right now, it's just going to give way too much map control over here. It looks like they are going to go for the stage dive, though. Are they going to be aggressing into a level 20 Tempo Storm? I'm not sure I completely agree with this, but here comes the boat. It's actually going to try and do as much damage as possible. Hasn't been taken out just yet. Storm Shield going down. Ravenous Spirit going to clean up Tazza. Fan's boat is immediately canceled out. Zix taking heavy, heavy damage, but now Syracuse is the one taking a lot of damage from the Ravenous Spirit. Zix going to go down. Three members of Cloud9 have fallen here. The bottom keep is still completely, or the bottom keep is completely gone, which means that is open to getting aggressive. Or they're just gonna go straight through the mid and then possibly straight to the core.
Yeah, they're just gonna try to push the end here. They've got a 40 second window without the healer or the tank on this team. And let me tell you, that is a tall order. Five members with full health and mana nearly. I mean, sieged up, they have three specialists. The siege damage is real. They're going for that big play. Ancestral Will cannot connect with KO. So very close. The damage output was there. But again, the core, the shields are gone. 60% dropping rapidly. Hammer, Rhaegar, Uther, you name it. No Uther, I lied. It's both.
No Uther, nothing left. And in fact, at the last second, oh, the missile actually stuck in midair. I've never seen a Napalm Strike missile before.
So attractive. It looks like a little airplane.
Yeah, it looks really cool. Looks like a small little Tassadar in mount form. All right, guys. Well, it looks like we've got our victors for the third place match.
Yeah, congratulations. Tempo Storm taking a 2-0 victory over Vortex. But, you know, well played to both teams. A really exciting series.
Yeah, that was awesome. Good to see Tempo Storm kind of getting back into that, but sad to see Cloud9 Vortex going to be taking fourth place. I always like the Cloud9 Vortex guys. We had Bobby Hank Hill on Town Hall, and he's just one of our favorite guests I think we've had yet. But still fourth place, going to be in the money, so they're going to be coming away, they're going to be walking away with $150. Tempo Storm's going to be walking away with $350. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we go on into the finals. It's going to be Complexity versus Cloud9 Maelstrom.
Complexity. No, but this is Maelstrom's chance to try to take a second Titan Arena in a row. They are the reigning champions from the first Titan Arena event, but Complexity here, they have that shot at the title. They've got that sponsorship. They have the motivation. They just came off a huge win versus Tempo Storm. It's going to be an incredible best of five series.
And that's, I think, going to be probably the pinnacle of tonight, because already we had Tempo Storm versus Complexity. Best of fives, went to five matches. But now we're going to be seeing two paired teams going up against each other. Guys, tweet it out. Let everybody know. I think we have everybody ready. So this is going to be a pretty short break, hopefully. And we'll be right back after this quick commercial break with the finals. Stay tuned.